So we had a global climate conference recently, as you know. It was called COP28, as you know, and it was held in the United Arab Emirates, as you know. And if you watched my summary video a couple of weeks back, you will also know my views of the proceedings. One of the more ostensibly positive declarations that we did get, though, from no fewer than 116 countries at the event, was a pledge to triple their renewable energy generation by 2030. There are plenty of analysts who argue that this sort of thing should have long since been regarded as the very bare minimum that any reasonably sizable and competent country should already have been well on course for achieving. But in the time-honoured tradition of COP meetings, it was instead trumpeted as some kind of heroic, Herculean achievement by world leaders to protect the future of your children. Anyway, I promised myself I wouldn't start wandering off into rhetoric this week. I've been doing a lot of that recently, so I won't go on about it, except to ask the obvious question that should naturally follow a proclamation like this one. How are they going to do that then? Hello, and welcome to Just Ever Think. There's actually quite a wide spectrum of opinion on renewables out there in the energy research and analysis world, ranging all the way from some of the more vocal fossil fuel advocates and nuclear industry sponsors who tell us that wind and solar are nothing more than the delusional pipe dream of an ideological far-left cult that ultimately wants to see us all living in caves.
Please help me, show me a roadmap for a phase out of fossil fuel that will allow for sustainable socio-economic development, unless you want to take the world back into caves.
Right through to, well, everyone else really, including organisations like RethinkX, who I featured a couple of years ago, and academics like Mark Jacobsen and others, who've spent years crunching the numbers and honing their projections, and who have demonstrated quite convincingly that the world can move to a fully 100% renewable energy infrastructure without us all having to go back to dressing like Raquel Welch. I don't know about you, but I haven't really got the figure for it anyway. Somewhere in that heady mix of opinion, though, attempting to offer what they see as the voice of cold, hard, market-driven pragmatism, perhaps with a hint of social conscience, are the folks at Bloomberg New Energy Finance, or BNEF. I realise, of course, there's almost as wide a spectrum of opinion about Mike Bloomberg as there is on renewables themselves, but I'll leave that for others to argue about. What Mike's team did, in a remarkably prescient move 10 days prior to the start of COP28, was to produce their own analysis, literally entitled Tripling Global Renewables by 2030. Uncanny. So what pearls of wisdom can we glean from this piece of work then? Well, right up front, it is going to be a challenge. They make no bones about that. Here's a few numbers to get us warmed up, so to speak. According to STATISTA, total global electricity generation capacity in 2022 was just over 8,500 gigawatts. And Bloomberg's own chart shows that renewables produced about 3,800 gigawatts of that total. The BNEF report shows that a tripling would therefore take renewables to 11,000 gigawatts or 11 terawatts by 2030, which is significantly more than total global capacity today. Now, quick memory jogger, watts are units of power and watt hours are units of energy. In other words, 1,000 watts or 1 kilowatt of power delivered for 1 hour equals 1 kilowatt hour of energy. And 1 kilowatt hour is what you and I would recognise as one unit when we look at our electricity bill. So the 8 terawatts of global electrical power generating capacity in 2022 produced a total global electrical energy consumption of about 25,000 terawatt hours. You're welcome. Anyway, according to BNEF, the last tripling of renewable capacity apparently took the world 12 years to achieve, and now we've got to triple a much bigger number, but this time in less than 8 years. The good news is that wind and solar are now the cheapest sources of new generation in most countries, and the BNEF team reckon that if we can triple capacity by 2030, then that would provide 62% of the total greenhouse gas emissions reductions that we need by that time if we want to stay on track for net zero in 2050. I know all these dates and numbers are a bit arbitrary, but you have got to have some kind of target to aim at, don't you? Otherwise we'd just have anarchy, and that wouldn't do at all. The more challenging news is that the only way to reach the goal is through a massive acceleration in industrial and governmental support. BNEF analysis shows that the rate of renewable investment would have to double from just over half a trillion US dollars in 2022 to nearly $1.2 trillion every year between now and the end of this decade. It also needs global investment in our woefully neglected electrical grids to reach about $780 billion a year by 2030, almost three times what was spent in 2022. And the world would need a slightly eye-watering 720 gigawatts of utility-scale battery capacity, which, in case you're wondering, is about 16 times what we have today. So yeah, busy, busy. It is absolutely within our gift, though, say the folks at BNEF. Existing supply chain capacity investments for solar, wind and batteries is apparently enough to get us there, albeit with a bit of pushing and shoving to get rid of stupid roadblocks like zombie projects in grid installation queues, for example. Solar PV installations are apparently rattling along nicely, most notably over in China, where a new capacity record seems to get broken about once a week or so, but also in plenty of other parts of the world as well. Wind power apparently needs a bit more of a concerted effort though, says BNEF. We could technically get to the tripling target number just using solar alone. But as the report points out, wind and solar are extremely complementary technologies, so it makes much more sense to build in that extra energy delivery security using both technologies rather than just relying on one. The detailed explanation for that gets a bit technical, I'm afraid. Bloomberg say their net zero scenario would require more than 22,000 terawatt hours of renewable energy by 2030. And that's largely based on 5.3 terawatts of solar capacity and 3.6 terawatts of wind. Now here's the technical bit. BNEF says that although renewable generation capacity tripled between 2010 and 2022, renewable energy supply only increased by a factor of 2.1. Why? Well, because a lot of new capacity was solar, and solar has a comparatively low capacity factor, which is a measure of how much real-world energy you get from a power source compared to how much you could get if the power source was running at 100% full tilt all the time. For solar, that ranges from about 30% in somewhere sunny like Chile, down to only about 11% in somewhere a bit more dunkelflouty like Germany or eastern China. The global average, according to Bloomberg's analysis, actually worked out at 13.2%. By contrast, wind farms had an average global capacity factor in 2022 of 27.2%. Hydro's in there as well, of course, with a global average of 40%, and geothermal came out at a whopping 68%. The thing is though, solar is now so dirt cheap, thanks to China, and so quick and easy to install, that it's effectively become the course of least resistance for green energy developers, who, like it or not, are just as driven by their financial bottom lines as any other energy producer in the world. So we need to somehow guard against that getting out of hand, says the BNEF team. They argue that a rapidly decarbonising world that's overly reliant on solar won't achieve as big an impact on electricity generation or emissions reductions as one with a more diverse mix of renewable technologies. It is all doable though. That's the point I think the BNEF paper is really trying to make here. We're certainly not limited by economics, because deploying more renewables has been demonstrated to be generally economically beneficial, especially in regions with rapidly rising electricity demand. And the size of the prize in terms of emission reductions is high indeed. You may have seen last week's video about energy efficiency, based largely on research carried out by the International Energy Agency, or IEA. And when you combine the findings of that report with what we've looked at so far today, you get a very powerful impact indeed, as the folks at yet another energy industry think tank, emberclimate.org, very kindly quantified for us in this recent article. They found that if the world did successfully combine the ramp up in renewables with the annual doubling of energy efficiency improvements from 2% today to the 4% that we looked at last week, then that would deliver 85% of cuts to unabated fossil fuel requirements by 2030 and more than half CO2 emissions by 2035. And then we really would be cooking on gas. Partly because we wouldn't be cooking on gas, if you see what I mean. Okay, so it is technically and economically feasible. The question is, can it actually be done in the real world? Well, not from where we're at today, says BNEF. Under current policies, we're on course for a projected 5.8 terawatts of solar capacity by 2030 and only 1.9 terawatts of wind. even when you add in all the other technologies like hydro and geothermal and so on, you only get to a 2030 total global renewable capacity of about 9 terawatts versus the 11 terawatt target. So what needs to change then? Well, according to the Bloomberg crew, the checklist for policymakers and regulators looks a bit like this. Remove barriers to access like unrealistic licensing requirements and ambiguity around land ownership. Remove the $1 trillion or so of annual explicit government subsidies that the fossil fuel industry still receives today. Improve and expand the auction process for new clean power projects and get fixed and predictable prices into offtake agreements. Make sure any new agreement is properly designed and assessed as being for the long-term good of a given power system. Facilitate strong competition between developers to get the best prices within the framework of quality and long-term suitability. Instigate massive investment in grid infrastructure to provide the right level of distribution capacity for the future and avoid the ridiculous amount of renewables curtailment that goes on today. Employ and train up a whole new workforce at municipal level to speed up the permitting process and deal much more quickly with necessary but currently very frustrating bottlenecks like environmental impact studies and appeals, including the creation of a robust, comprehensive, centralized database of geographical conditions and biodiversity. In short, pretty much a complete redesign of the entire global energy industry as we've known it for about the last 5 or 6 decades. And if we could have that done by Thursday, that'd be lovely. I'm quite sure you've got your own take on the energy transition and the role that renewables will need to play in it. So as always, feel free to jump down to the comments section below and leave your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to our Patreon supporters who keep ads and sponsorship messages out of all these programs. Now, I know I say this every week, but subscribing to the channel here on YouTube costs precisely nothing at all, and it really does make a difference to how the algorithm chooses which videos to offer people. While I've been ranting and raving about the fossil fuel industry and the COP28 process in various videos over the past few weeks, YouTube has decided to effectively shut down the channel's circulation almost completely. So while I'm getting back on track with a better mix of sustainable technology videos for 2024, you could really help to kickstart that process by clicking down there somewhere or on that icon there. Most important of all though, thanks for watching. Have a great week and remember to just have a think. See you next week.